Greetings, my name is Monty Martin, and welcome back to Isadora 3. In this series of video tutorials, I'm going to be introducing you to the core features and functionality of Isadora 3. Now today, we are going to take a look at one of my favorite features in Isadora, and in fact, one of the features of Isadora that got me most excited about the application when I started learning it, and that is live video. Over the years, I have always been fascinated and inspired by all the applications for live video capture in both performance and installation in my projection designs. And I think for a lot of Isadora users, the potential of how easy and straightforward it is to get live video working and project it out into the world with Isadora is one of the most compelling and exciting features for a brand new Isadora user. That said, there are a lot of considerations that go into working with live video. And while the setup and configuration in Isadora itself is relatively easy to grasp, one of the biggest challenges when working with live video are all the hardware considerations external to Isadora itself that make the process quite complicated. There are many different things that you might need to be aware of when you are choosing to work with a live video capture system, not the least of which is the choice of which camera you would like to use for recording and capturing video and bringing that into Isadora. Depending on the type of camera that you have access to or that you're choosing to use, you may need to use a wide range of third-party hardware and software to get that into Isadora's live capture system. This is why one of the easiest things to begin with is simply experimenting with the built-in webcam on your laptop computer, or a webcam like this one, which is a Logitech Brio. The Logitech C920 is another very popular option. And the reason why these ones are so great when you're just starting out is because all you need is a USB cable to plug them into your computer and you're pretty much ready to go. You can usually get little tripods to attach these to and you can start experimenting with things right away out of the box. And since most of these range in price from about $100 to $300 USD, they usually make a very cost-effective way of getting something that isn't attached to your laptop screen out there that you can use to capture a performer or a performance space in some way and something that you can move around in a bit of a flexible manner. Now, you might also have a pretty nice camera of your own. Maybe you've got a DSLR or a camcorder or a mirrorless camera that you might be interested in using with Isadora. Now, not all of these cameras are created equally, and some of these cameras have features and functionality which make them better for video rather than photography. In particular, cameras made by Canon and Nikon tend to not have the best or most user-friendly video capture features. These cameras often don't offer a clean video output and often shut off after 30 minutes of recording or inactivity. Whereas cameras by Sony and Panasonic, often have clean signals that you can very easily use with a capture card, and they usually stay on as long as they've got battery power or a AC power adapter attached to them. When I'm working with my Panasonic GH5, I use one of these guys, which is a Elgato Game Capture HD60S. These ones are very popular with live streamers and they're very easy to use. They connect to your computer with USB and then they connect to your camera through its HDMI port on the side of it. And basically this device for about $200 USD transforms any camcorder, mirrorless camera, or DSLR with an HDMI output into a webcam that is very serviceable, allowing you to use all those beautiful lenses, get that really nice picture quality, and have all the flexibility and functionality that you get by being able to have a very long cable run and position the camera exactly where you need. Not the least of which is when you're working with a USB camera, if you have a camera operator, they don't have any preview box or any sort of viewfinder, whereas with a mirrorless camera or a like mine, you get that out there so that you can have a separate operator on the camera and a separate operator running Isadora. Pretty handy things to keep in mind. So this is why all these complexities mean that when you are setting out to use live video with Isadora for a performance project or installation, I highly recommend you give yourself lots of time to test the setup and be prepared to have to acquire new equipment, whether that is an extension cable, an adapter, a capture card, or something. Don't necessarily grab the things that you have on hand and expect all of that third-party equipment to immediately talk to each other in a perfect way. It does require a little bit of research, planning, and forethought. If you're ever looking for help and advice, I strongly recommend visiting the Troikatronix communities either on Facebook or our user forums and posting there and asking, hey, I've got this equipment. What is the best way to get it to talk to my computer? Once the equipment's talking to your computer, it's fairly easy to get it to work with Isadora. You just usually have to spend those extra steps to make sure. So what I'm going to do today is I've set up a little performance space and I've got one of my Logitech Brios plugged right in, and I am going to get this rigged up with Isadora so we can capture it. Now, the final thing to keep in mind is that it is also recommended to connect all of your hardware and software together and then power up Isadora last when you are working with live video. This is a great order of operations when you're running a show or getting started with one, because it ensures that all the hardware and software is recognized in the same order. I also like to label all my cables and the ports they're plugged into, and this ensures that if you do have to strike your setup, that once you plug everything back in again and power up Isadora again, everything is going to be recognized in the exact same order. Isadora does a pretty good job of recognizing new hardware when it is connected to your computer, even when it is already running. But by following this process, you make absolutely sure that there's consistency night after night. So let's look at Isadora itself. I've got a blank patch up right now, and that's pretty much all we're gonna need to work with for now. If you don't have your own camera external to use, as long as you have a built-in webcam, you'll be able to follow along with me here today. I'm gonna go up to Input and hit Live Capture Settings. And that's going to open up my live capture settings window. This allows me to control both the video capture and the audio capture for Isadora, both cameras and microphones. Now, there's a few key buttons to just be aware of right away. First of all, if you are later connecting devices while Isadora is running, hitting the Scan for Devices button will basically tell Isadora, hey, look for anything else connected to my computer. So if you are plugging other things on while Isadora is running and you want to start using those right away, hit Scan for Devices and Isadora should find them right away. Of course, also we have the Start and Stop Live Capture buttons. Those are separate buttons so that we can get things going very, very clearly. We're going to worry about those in just a moment because we have a little bit of setup to do first. The first thing that I want to do is go to my Channel Enable and Selection menu. You can see here that I'm currently on Channel 1, which is enabled, but this drop-down menu allows me to select up to 4 different channels of video input. Isadora supports up to 4 simultaneous inputs at a time. Just remember, though, that your computer will need considerable muscle to do 4 HD live camera inputs at the same time. You'll also need the right hardware to make sure that you can actually get 4 sources in. Now, if I go to channel 2, you'll notice that I do have that enabled, but if I go to channel 3, I don't. It's not checked off. I'm actually going to go back to channel 2 and I'm going to uncheck it to disable that so that Isadora is not trying to capture a channel of video that I don't have any hardware connected to. It is a worthwhile thing to make sure that only the channels that you are actually needing to use are enabled. And in this case, I'm just going to capture video from one camera, so I'm only going to enable channel 1. Furthermore, I'm just going to use the Apple driver for myself, but if you are using a Blackmagic capture card, you might want to use the Blackmagic drivers instead. And depending on what type of device you are using, different drivers will offer you better or worse types of performance. So be aware of the driver that you're using for capture, and you may even need to play with this to find out the best and most optimal responsiveness for your video capture. But for now, I'm going to leave these at their defaults. Now I want to select my video input device. So I'm going to go to this video input section here, and I'm going to use the drop-down menu device. Right now it's set to none, but you'll see that I get a couple of different options here. Now, you might see a different number than what I do because I have additional software installed on my computer, such as CamTwist and the OBS virtual camera that allow me to get virtual capture sources. But right now, I can see my FaceTime HD camera, which is the built-in camera on my Mac, and my Logitech Brio, which is plugged in with USB. So I'm going to select the Logitech Brio from my list. And if I want to as well, I can change the resolution of my capture device. So the resolution drop-down menu lets you change amongst all the compatible resolutions that your device supports. Usually the native resolution is the highest value in this case. In the case of my Logitech Brio, it is a 4K capture. And I am not capturing any sound at this time, so I'm going to leave the sound input set to none. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit Start Live Capture. And there is our fun little bit of video there. I've got a few of my LED lights with a little bit of a blue backlight to create our fun little scene there. So what I can do is I can hit Show Preview, and I will actually get a small preview of what my camera is pulling in. We can see that the video is running nice and smoothly there. A little bit fuzzy. I probably should get some more lighting in on my scene. But I think this will be great for our purposes right here today. And I can just close this preview window because I don't need it. So I got that little preview window down there. Of course, you can always change the settings of your video preview windows. That was a very big preview window because it's the full 4K resolution. So now I'm going to close this live capture settings window and actually pipe things into my stage. Because if I go to output show stages, I've got nothing here on my output in Isadora at all, because just like anything else in Isadora, we need to have a projector actor and a video source. When we're working with live cameras, what we're going to be using is a video sources actor called the Video In Watcher, and I'm going to bring that into my scene right here. The Video In Watcher is very, very straightforward. It actually doesn't have a lot of options here. We have one input on it that allows us to select the channel that it's receiving video from. So in this case, I'm gonna leave it to the default of channel one. And then we just have the video output, which I'm just gonna get a projector actor and plug these two into each other. And there we have it. There is my live video source being pulled in from my Logitech Brio right into Isadora from there. And that is the basic premise behind getting live video up and running. Now, I'll just show you how we might do this if we wanted to use a secondary camera as well. First, I'm going to go back up to Input, Live Capture Settings. And in this case, I'm going to go down to Channel 2, and I'm going to check that off to Enable it. And for my video input device list, I'm going to choose my FaceTime camera. And you'll see as soon as I choose it, it isn't yet active yet. I actually need to stop my live capture and start my live capture again. And there we go. So you can see me and all my green screen glory in that little preview window there. And now I will actually then close this window, and I'll need to get another video in watcher set to channel 2. And now it's up to me to decide whether I want to mix these two things together or whether I want to overlay them. I think what I'll do is I will put in a video mixer actor, and I will disconnect that there, put the first camera and put in the first video mixer, the second into that one, plug that all into my projector. And with the video mixer, I can plug both the sources into the top two videos, and I can now switch between these by just changing the mix amount property. And there's that video, and there's that video. Of course, because I'm using two separate cameras to record this and record this video, they're not going to quite be perfectly in sync, but when you're working with it in real time and you're not using separate cameras to record a tutorial and work in this way, you'll find that the delay on this is actually more dependent on your hardware itself than anything beyond that. So, and we could also do a 50 mix like that. So that just shows a very basic patch. In fact, to augment this a little more, maybe let's grab that mouse watcher from before and put the horizontal position into the mix amount. And now by moving my mouse pointer left to right, I can change between my two camera sources really, really simply and easily. And so if you're building this basic little patch like this with an external camera, like a webcam and your built-in camera, it's a great way to experiment with compositing just more than one live video feed at a time and seeing the kind of fun effects that you can generate in this way. Now, we can simply stop the live capture at any time by going to Input, Stop Live Capture. You'll notice that when we do that, our stage goes black and all of our lines here from our video in watchers are red. So you will need to turn on your live capture in order to get that going, whether that's at the start of your project or at the start of whatever scene you want to bring that in with. One of the handy ways that you can actually control this is there is a useful actor here called Capture Control. And the Capture Control actor, when it is triggered, will actually turn on or off the capture from whichever corresponding channel you have going. So if I now take out my video mixer here and just leave that first video in watcher, and I hit the trigger on this capture control, there is my live video feed now. Now, you'll notice though, if I hit the capture control trigger again, nothing happens. In order to start the capture with the capture control actor, I actually need to change the function to none. And when that trigger is received, it will turn off the capture. So if you want to do something with your keyboards or with your other functionality to turn on and off your video capture, you will need two capture control actors. One with the function set to none to turn it off, and another capture control actor set to the function that you want to enable, in this case, video and audio, or it can simply be video, to turn it on. So that way you can both control it manually by using the live capture settings and stop and start live capture up here in the menu. But if you do want to automate something and turn the live capture on and off using actors, the capture control actor allows you to do this. This can be quite beneficial when you're in a large Isadora project. And let's say, for instance, you have 100 scenes in your project, but not every single scene is using your live video source. By using the capture control actors, you can turn the live video sources and the capture on and off when they're not needed. And doing this will actually conserve processing power. So this is the thing to be aware of when you are capturing live video. It is a very processor intensive task. And so if you're capturing multiple channels of video simultaneously and doing lots of other video processing and video effects, you can really drive up your system resources quite heavily. So in a larger project, you can economize by using the capture control actors to turn your capture on and off in a programmatic way, rather than having to tell your operator to go up to the input menu every time and manually stop and start it. You can simply program your entire patch around that idea, perhaps by using enter scene triggers or keyboard watchers to trigger those. Be sure to check out our prior tutorial on the basics of sound playback and triggers to see how that works. Well, that about covers it all for today. We have looked at how to bring in our live video capture sources into Isadora. We talked about some of the hardware and software concerns that we might have along the way, and looked at some of the useful actors that we can use to help automate these features and functionality. Once the video capture is enabled and the video in watcher is in your scene, you can use it basically in the same way that you use a movie player or a picture player. As long as it's connected to a projector, it will behave in basically the same way, although it doesn't quite have all of the other configurability options that the movie player does, because the movie player has all that to control the playback. And in this case, we're working with things in real time. In some of our future tutorials, we'll look at some of the other examples of how we can gain more precise control with our video capture to create some really interesting effects and even record the video as we're capturing it. That's all for today. We'll see you next time in the next workshop.